Good morning. Welcome to West Swamp Mennonite Church. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We're glad you're here this morning, and we hope you find blessing and encouragement in our service. This new year, I've heard and seen a lot of marketing and advertising that is persuading people to focus on themselves. For example, one TV personality rebranded 2023 to be 2020 Me, or an online ad that read, "The most important thing to do in 2023 is to follow your dreams, love yourself, and care about your own happiness," with the word "own" being capitalized. Another read, "This 2023, be you, do you, for you." Now, maybe I've just been tuned into this trend, but how much more glaringly obvious can the selfishness be? I am all for positive affirmations and inspirational quotes, but this doesn't sound quite right. This doesn't sound like Jesus. We are called to a different 2023, a different kind of love and happiness. Jesus is our light and our reason for sharing the light. Today, we'll look at what it means to be attached to Jesus. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and this time to worship. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus, to love us and show us how to love each other. Help us to live with grace and mercy and forgiveness. Help us to love people well, and we pray that they see Jesus instead of ourselves. Bless us this morning as we worship together. Amen.
And now let's stand as we worship our King.
Wonderful love, our shield and haven.
And this is our story that we love to tell.
Testament scripture reading this morning is from Isaiah 49, verses 1 through 7. The servant of the Lord. Listen to me, you islands. Hear this, you distant nations. Before I was born, the Lord called me. From my mother's womb, he has spoken my name. He made my mouth like a sharpened sword, and in the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me into a polished arrow and concealed me in his quiver. He said to me, "You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will display my splendor." But I said, "I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing at all. Yet what is due me is in the Lord's hand, and my reward is with God." And now the Lord says, "He who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him and gather Israel to himself, for I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has been my strength. He says, it is too small a thing for you to be my servant, to restore the tribes of Jacob and bring back those of Israel I have kept. I will also make you a light for the Gentiles, that my salvation may reach the ends of the earth." This is what the Lord says. The Redeemer of the Holy One of Israel, to him who was despised and abhorred by the nation, to the servant of rulers, Kings will see you and stand up. Princes will see and bow down. Because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you.
So if the ushers will get ready to take the offering, let's pray together. God, we thank you for this opportunity to give. We thank you for this opportunity to contribute to what you are doing in the world. And so we pray that you would take these gifts and that you would multiply them and that you would use them to build your kingdom in our congregation and in our community and around this world that you love so much. And so we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. So the other scripture this morning is from the New Testament, from the Gospel of John, chapter 1. So if you have your pew Bible there in front of you, or you brought your Bible with you, you can turn to that, to John, chapter 1, verse 29. And people have been asking John the Baptist about his identity, and he has been disavowing that he is the Messiah. He's been saying, no, it's not me. You're still looking for someone who is yet to come. And so in verse 29, the next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, 'A man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel." Then John gave this testimony: "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one." The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah," that is the Christ, and he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which when translated is Peter. These are words from God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Pray with me. God, we thank you for these moments to gather together this morning around the scriptures. And we pray that in these moments that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher. And we pray that the outcome of these moments would be that more and more in who we are and in how we live, the life of Jesus is visible. And so we pray in his name. Amen. How many of you have brothers? Raise your hand. Okay. All right. What is the craziest thing that one of your brothers has ever talked you into doing? Just when you can think of it, just say it. Maybe you have very calm brothers, but I feel like, Rod, I think you want to turn down the gain on my microphone. Now, people are laughing, but nobody's saying anything, which is...
Climbing to the top of a willow tree.
Climbing to the top of a willow tree. Okay, did you get back down? Okay, all right. That's good news. Yeah.
Jumping into a creek and you couldn't swim.
Oh, boy. Okay, jumping into a creek when you don't know how to swim. That's pretty risky. Did you get... Obviously, you got out okay. Yeah. Yeah. Somebody else. Craziest thing your brother talked you into doing. Yeah.
When we were younger, my father's cabin and my brother decided we should walk to the top of the mountain. And we didn't tell our parents where we were going anymore for quite a long time.
Okay. So an unscheduled expedition to the top of the mountain with your brothers, not telling your parents where you were going. Okay? All right. Anybody else? Crazy thing your brother taught you into doing. All right. So I don't have brothers, but I have brothers-in-law, and my brothers-in-law are great. I love them. It has been a huge gift in my life being married to Sue to get to have brothers-in-law. But when I first started dating Sue and we first got engaged, I was on trial with my brothers-in-law. They wanted to figure out what kind of man I was. And so I have a vivid recollection. We had all gone on a ski trip together, and we were hanging out, and I have this one brother-in-law, Dave, And Dave is kind of an amateur bodybuilder. Dave is one of these guys who didn't grow up particularly big, but then when he was in college, he really blossomed, and he became a very athletic guy. See if I can keep preaching while I'm doing that. So Dave became very athletic. And is very strongly built. And like I said, he's kind of an amateur bodybuilder. And so one of the things that Dave does is Dave takes an incredible number of supplements. He just, everything is a supplement. Everything is like a protein powder or something like that. And I don't know if you guys have noticed this about me, but I'm not particularly athletic. And so I'm getting to know Dave. I'm getting to know my other brothers-in-law. And we're on this ski trip. And Dave says, would you like to try some of my supplements? And so I'm like, sure. I'm getting to know you. I'm going to do anything that doesn't seem likely to land me in jail. Bring me those supplements. And so Dave brings out what looks to me initially to be like a double handful of supplement pills. And he says, this is what I take every day, and it's really good. It's very helpful for me, helps me get stronger. And so I'm like, where's a glass of water? I'm going to take these. And I just toss them all back, this big double handful of pills, and I wash it down with a little bit of water, and I swallow a time or two, and I'm like, that's great. Are we going to do this again tomorrow? And so I had instant credibility with my brothers-in-law because I was willing to do this crazy thing that my brother-in-law Dave wanted me to do. So I have had that experience over the years, and they don't test me anymore. After 11 years of marriage, I've made it with my brothers-in-law. But it was always interesting to be on the front end of those relationships. Now, Andrew and Peter have grown up together. And we don't know from the scripture which of them is the oldest. We kind of think that it was probably Peter because his name always gets mentioned first. And you know how that goes. But in this passage, what starts off happening is John has been doing his ministry of baptizing out by the Jordan River. People have been coming to him from all over to the Jordan River, and they're being baptized by John in the Jordan. And you have to remember that when the children of Israel first came into the land of promise, into the place that God had given them on oath, just like God dried up the Red Sea so that they could leave Egypt ahead of the Egyptians, God dried up the Jordan so that they could pass into the promised land, so that they could enter into that place that God had provided for them. And so John is doing these baptisms, and it's not just that he's like, well, we got to find water. Where is there water around here? He is very intentionally baptizing people in the Jordan River as a declaration that they are becoming the new people of God. They are becoming the people through whom God is building God's kingdom. God is doing a new thing in the world through them. And he's baptizing them for repentance. They are turning away from their sins. They are turning away from a life that's directed around themselves. Like Katie was talking about, they are turning away from that moment of selfishness, from that attitude of self-interest. And they are saying, God, I want what you want for me. I want you to be in control of my life. And we remember how there were some of the Pharisees who came out from Jerusalem to be baptized by John. And John called them a brood of snakes. I mean, he said, why are you coming out here? He said, you need to produce fruit in keeping with repentance. You need to have a transformation of your life. Your life needs to be different to show that you are turning away from yourself and turning toward God. And so what happened out there in the wilderness out there by the Jordan River was John is doing these baptisms, and people are coming to him from all over, and Jesus comes to him to be baptized. And so this is where this passage gets a little bit strange, because in the Gospels, in the other Gospel accounts of Jesus' baptism, Jesus and John obviously know each other. I mean, they're cousins. They've kind of grown up together. And so you would think that in this passage in John, in the Gospel of John, that it would still show that connection that there is between them, that they are cousins, that they know each other, and they have that conversation about, you know, it's not, I shouldn't be baptizing you, you should be baptizing me. No, let's go ahead and do it like this because this is the right way to go. But instead, in the Gospel of John, we have John saying a couple of times, I didn't know who I was looking for. I didn't know this one who was going to come. And so he's been testifying that he's not the Messiah. He's been testifying that there's someone else that is to come. And so at this point, he's just spending time with his followers, with people who have become followers of John. And then he sees Jesus. And see, Jesus has moved his residence. He's living in Capernaum now. And so Jesus is there, and John sees Jesus. And he says, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. What a thing to say. I mean, there's just this guy, this carpenter, walking down the road. And John points to him and says, look, the Son of God, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And for those who heard John, for those who heard his testimony about Jesus, this brings in a whole bunch of ideas that they have about what the Messiah is going to be like, about what this chosen one is going to be like, and about who they've been waiting for all these years. Because they know that God is going to act decisively, that God is going to bring forward this Messiah, and that the Messiah is going to lead the nation of Israel, the people of God, into a new world, into a new way of life. Now, for them, mostly, what the Messiah coming would mean for them would mean an end to Roman rule and occupation. It would mean that the people who were oppressing them were going to be kicked out. And so they were expecting someone who was going to be a powerful political leader, someone who was perhaps going to be a military leader, someone who was going to displace the Romans. And so they would get to go back to the time and the place when they were running their own country, when they were not occupied by foreigners, when they didn't have people around them who were doing all kinds of things that were repugnant to them. So John comes along and John says, this is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And then John says, look, I didn't really know who I was supposed to be waiting for, but then the one who sent me to baptize said, the one that you see the Spirit of God rest and remain on, he's the one that you've been waiting for. He's the one that you've been anticipating. And so then the next day happens, and Jesus comes by again. John sees Jesus again, and he says, look, the Lamb of God. And this time, something else happens, something that's different happens. Andrew and another person, we don't ever learn his name, are there, and they're disciples of John. But when John points to Jesus and describes Jesus as the Lamb of God, they stop following John and they begin to literally follow Jesus. They begin to follow him where he's headed. And Jesus discerns that. Jesus recognizes that. He turns around and he says, what do you want? And they say, Rabbi, where are you staying? And for them to call Jesus rabbi is significant. It's a big deal, because to say that someone is a rabbi, to say that someone is a teacher, is to say this is someone that I can learn how to live from. This is someone that I can learn the way to go from. This is someone that I can take direction from. And so for you and for me, what it means when we say that Jesus is Lord, when we say that Jesus is our master, when we say that Jesus is the one who runs our lives, it means that it's from him that we take direction. It's from him that we find the path to follow in life. It's for him that we are continually turning away from ourselves and toward him so that we can follow him in the ins and outs of life, so that his life can be reproduced in us. And so they begin to follow Jesus, and they go and they spend the rest of the day with him. And from that moment on, they have been attached to Jesus. Now think about how hard this is for John, because John has had this incredible ministry. He's been gathering people from all over the land of Israel. People have been coming from a far distance to be baptized by John in the Jordan. And there's been this incredible response to his ministry, but he has heard from God that he is supposed to start detaching people from himself and attaching them to Jesus. He says in another place, he, Jesus, must increase and I must decrease. So John very consciously says, I'm going to stop attaching people to myself and I'm going to start attaching them to Jesus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And this is great. I mean, this is the beginning. This is the ground level. This is where everything starts in the Gospel of John. And so Andrew does an incredible thing. Right after he started following Jesus, right after he's begun to walk with him, works better when it's in my sweater and it doesn't fall down to the ground. So when Andrew begins to follow Jesus, the thing that is uppermost in his mind is, I've got to tell my brother. I've got to tell Peter. Now we know from other places in the Gospels that Andrew and Peter are actually business partners as well as brothers. They have a boat. They have men who work with them. They're out there in the Sea of Galilee fishing day in and day out. But Andrew has gotten caught up in this movement around John the Baptist. He's become a follower of his. And so you can kind of imagine Peter's like, well, Andrew, you're not putting in the hours on the boat like you ought to be. What's going on? Why are you following this guy around who eats bugs and honey? Why are you following this guy around who's wrapped up in an old camel skin? But Andrew finds Peter and he says, we have found the Messiah. We have found the Messiah. We found the one that we've been looking for, this one that you and I were born to wait for. We're born to anticipate this one who was to come. We have found him. And Andrew takes his brother Peter to Jesus. And he introduces him to Jesus. And Peter gets a new name. I mean, Jesus says, you're Simon, but I'm going to give you a new name. I'm going to call you Rock. I'm going to call you Cephas. And it just means rock or stone. But nobody had ever called Peter that before. Nobody had ever seen that in him before. Until Jesus comes into his life and redefines how he sees himself. And for you and for me, that's what happens when Jesus comes into our lives, when we begin to see our lives in the light of who Jesus is. It redefines how we think of ourselves. And we can stop thinking about ourselves simply as someone who has a job or who goes to school or who has a family or who lives in a certain place. And we begin to see ourselves as people of destiny, as people for whom God is building God's kingdom in our world. Because to become a follower of Jesus, to become attached to Jesus, that's what that means. is that our lives are no longer our own. Our lives don't belong to us anymore. Because if you are a follower of Jesus, what you have said is, Jesus gets to run my life. And Jesus gets to live his life out through me, in my world, in my relationships, in my net, wherever I find myself, in my interactions with the people around me, Jesus gets to express himself and build his kingdom. Now, if you think about Andrew, what he did takes a lot of courage. To go to his brother and to say, look, this is something new and different and completely revolutionary. This is going to turn your life upside down. And you need to say yes to this. You need to say yes to this man because he is the one for whom we have been waiting. And I just want to challenge you this week. I want to encourage you. There's going to be a moment this week when you're in conversation with someone and you can just say, you know, my life is attached to Jesus. The reason why I do the things that I do, the reason why I make the decisions that I make is because I'm a follower of Jesus. And that has made all the difference for me. And right now you're saying, Michael, wait a minute. I'm a Mennonite. I don't do that. I mean, we serve people. We do things for people. We're the compassionate folks. But gosh, talking about Jesus, that's something else entirely. That's okay. You keep on showing people in how you live the love of Jesus. But I would encourage you just to say there's going to be an opportunity for you not just to demonstrate who Jesus is by how you act, but for you actually to speak a word of testimony about his place in your life. And when that moment comes, don't pass it up. Don't let it go by. Make the most of it. Because having become attached to Jesus, it's now our responsibility. It's now our possibility to help other people become attached to him as well. Amen.
The end of Michael's sermon reminds me of the verse in 1 Peter, I think 3:15 maybe. Always be ready to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. So as this song says, let us speak with boldness. So would you stand as we sing, come what may, paso lo que pase, ven. We ask you for your power, paso lo que pase, ven. Strength for every hour, pase lo que pase, ven. Oh, the path be lonely, paso lo que pase, ven. We will obey you only, paso lo que pase, ven. Come what may.
So now is the time in our service when if you have a comment about the sermon, if you have a prayer concern, if you have an announcement to make, you can do that. If you'll just raise your hand, Mark will bring the microphone to you, and if you just say your name as you share.
Randy Rush, just a reminder that 2 weeks from today will be the annual business meeting here in the, well, I'm not sure it'll be here. It'll be either here or in the fellowship hall at 1 o'clock. And there will be a late luncheon provided after the service. There's a sign-up sheet in the fellowship hall for that, and I think also related to that sign-up sheet is a request to bring a dessert. So annual meeting in 2 weeks, luncheon after the service provided, if you can, please sign up to bring a dessert.
Elaine Probst, I'd like to have prayers for my nephews, Peter Engelman's son, Rory. He's 5 years old. They live in New Hampshire. After having eye problems, they did an MRI and found a mass on his brain, which after a biopsy was determined to be cancerous. They have been given two options, which now they have to determine which option they are going to take. It's a 2-hour drive to Boston Children's Hospital, which is where they have been being treated. So prayers for Rory and his whole family.
Lee Probst, in response to Michael's, when you first started, I was wishing my brother could be here. I'm a little older than he is, and I know he could have told you some maybe stories you wouldn't want to hear.
I got a question, too. Uh-huh. What happened when you took those pills?
Well, it was supposed to have some effects on me that actually didn't happen, so that was good. They were just going to be interesting effects. They didn't happen. So,
Jan Wien, I just want to remind everybody today's the last day to sign up for the senior luncheon, which will be this Thursday at noontime. So please do so today so we have an idea of how many people will be attending.
Joan, since we're talking about food, today is lunch bunch. After church, we will be meeting at Benner Hall in Richland Town, so everyone is invited. If you don't know where it is, you can hang around and we'll either carpool or follow each other. Thanks.
Matt Mood. I just want to follow up with what Randy said about the annual business meeting. I feel it's very important that as many people come out as possible. Last year, we had a very small crowd that came out and virtual. And I think it's very important to our church and our outlook for the church for the future. We did have a lot of members in the past years that we lost, and maybe they had concerns that they never brought up, and it's the time to talk about what's on your heart and how you feel and what you expect to see in the future with the church. And I think it's very important. I know last year we had a lot of members that morning in the service, and nobody came out for the meeting, and that's very hard when you know, we're a church family and we should all stick together. And if there's concerns on each other or of our heart of the church, we need to bring them out and be spoken, because if we don't, our church, it's sad to say, will not provide for the future. And I think that's something that's very important for me, that seeing our church move on for the future and have a future here. So I encourage everybody possible, and tell your friend and family that are members of the church, please come out and support us that day and bring your feelings to the table. So I just encourage everybody to come out. Thank you. And then also on the projector, I have a small story there I like to bring forward. And that evening, Olivia and I were sitting around the house and we were talking and said, let's just go up to the church and see what we can look at the projector. And somebody mentioned to me last Sunday in church, hey, you know who would know about that would be Bruce Baumer. And I said, yeah, he probably would. So I didn't reach out to Bruce, but I should have. And it's funny because this morning when Bruce came, I spoke to him and he told me what the problem was right away. But last Sunday night, me and Olivia came and we looked at it and we diagnosed it, that we didn't have power there. So I said to Olivia, I said, I'm going to go upstairs in the attic. And she's like, okay. And I was never in the attic before, and it was dark out, and it's behind the organ there. And we crawled up the ladder and I went in and I had the flashlight and I'm looking, and I just went up real slow. I thought, didn't know if something was going to come at me or what. So I went up the ladder, and when I got up there, things had changed for me. Like, wow. Like, I wasn't scared no more. Well, I was a little scared going up in there, since I didn't know what I was looking at or going for. So when I got up there, my mind just eased, and I felt I was very comfortable, and I just stared and looked, and Olivia's like, what are you doing, Dad? Where are you at? And I didn't answer her, and I was just taking it all in. The history of our church that is beyond these walls, with the beams and the rafters and the hands of the people that built this church, just is amazing. You know what I mean? We wouldn't have this church today if those people back when they built this church took the time. And just, you think how hard it was to get them beams in place. And if you could see what it looked like with the hand-cut beams and rafters, it's just amazing. And it just makes me think, you know, there was a lot of people that put a lot of love and hard work into this church. And I just think we should pray for them, even though they're not here anymore, and their families, and just thank them for what they have done for us to build this church. It's just amazing, the structure of what we have here, that we maybe sometimes take for granted for what we have, but we have a very sound building to worship in, and that's great. Getting back to the switch, we trace it down, Olivia's like, Dad, there's a switch down here, and it turns the projector on. So if I would have just reached out to Bruce, he could have told us, hey, somebody probably turned the switch off. So if you look up in the left corner there where the buzzer is, there's a light switch, and it turns the projector power off and on. So that's all it was. Thank you.
Glenn, hi. The Mission Commission is planning our events for this coming year, and the first one for January and February is the MCC Relief Kits. As we look in our own country and some of the things that are going on in some of the places with storms, there's needs there. There's also needs overseas, like Ukraine. And last year we did very well collecting these items. There are notes down on one of the tables in the vestibule with a list on it of the items we need, and we'll eventually post the date that we'll be collecting these to go out in February.
Anybody else? Okay. Well, let's pray together. God, we thank you for your abiding presence with us. And we thank you that you are quicker to answer our prayers than we are to offer them. And so we ask for grace to open our hearts to you, to open our lives to you. God, we pray for Rory. We pray that your hand would be stretched out to touch his body and to bring healing. We pray for his family as they care for him. We pray for the nurses and doctors that are looking after him, that they would have wisdom and skill from you to know best how to treat him. So God, we invite you to do what you delight to do more than we can ask, to do more than we can even imagine, through your power that's at work in us because of the resurrection of your Son, our Lord Jesus. And so we pray in his name. Amen.
Would you all stand for our last song? Something we all know, this little light of mine, we are called to be a light to the nations. Let's be bright.
So go from this place to let the light of your life shine. Go from this place in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.